This video is sponsored by Skillshare. Hey, welcome to 12 Tone. Let me show you a magic trick. Here's a perfectly ordinary major scale. And like any good magician, I'm gonna cut it in half. If we just draw a line straight through the middle here, we see that there's four notes on either side. Now if we look at the structures of those notes, we see the bottom half starts with a whole step, then another whole step, then a half step, while the top half starts with a whole step, then another whole step, then a half step. Wait. That sounds familiar. We've taken a non-symmetrical scale and chopped it up into two identical mini-scales, and if that's not your idea of a great magic trick, then yeah, okay, fair enough, but still, it's pretty cool. So what's going on? Well, these groups of four notes are called tetrachords, which literally means four notes because names are hard. Still, goofy name or not, tetrachords are a really powerful tool for building scales. You can take any seven-note scale, add in the octave, and then chop it up into a lower tetrachord and an upper tetrachord. Because the root and the octave are fixed points, we know where the lower tetrachord starts and where the upper one ends, which means all we need to do is choose which ones we're going to use, and voila, we've made a whole scale. For instance, as we saw, using two of these makes the major scale, so we call it the major tetrachord. Again, names are hard. But minor isn't quite so simple. If we look at the lower tetrachord, the half step is in the middle, whereas in the upper one, it's right at the beginning. This means that minor scales require two different kinds of tetrachords in order to construct. The lower one is generally called the minor tetrachord because it's the one that feels more characteristically minor. The other one is sometimes called the upper minor tetrachord, but I prefer to just call it Phrygian. That way it gets to have a bit more of its own identity. These three together make up the simplest group of tetrachords, but there's plenty of scales we can't make with just them. Like harmonic minor has this big leap in the middle of its upper tetrachord, which doesn't exist in anything we've looked at so far. Here we've got a brand new kind of tetrachord. Instead of having two whole steps and a half step, it's got two half steps and then a minor third. This version, with the leap in the middle, is often called the harmonic tetrachord because it comes from harmonic minor. In theory, we could also put the leap at the bottom, or the top, but you don't tend to see that in actual scales, so we don't really have names for them, at least that I could find. Anyway, now seems like a good time to talk about the Greeks, because they invented this tetrachord stuff a long time ago. Like, a really long time ago. They traced their roots back to at least the work of the ancient Greek theorist Aristoxenes, a student of Aristotle. There's a lot of really fun, really complicated tuning stuff going on with the Greek tetrachords, but for now, I'm just going to approximate them in modern tuning, because what I really want to focus on is the structures. If you like tuning math, though, it's well worth looking up the details. Or you could just wait a bit. I'm sure I'm going to make a whole video about Greek tuning theory at some point. Back to Aristoxenes, though, he defined three different varieties of tetrachords, which he called genera, based on the intervals they're made of. In all three genera, the top and bottom notes are always a perfect fourth apart. The only thing that changed were the two notes in the middle. So in the diatonic genus, we have this, where the intervals are a half step and two whole steps. This resembles our Phrygian tetrachord from earlier, and by rotating the intervals around, we can find the major and minor ones too. In effect, they're all variations of the same basic pattern. We can also see that in the harmonic tetrachord, which is related to Aristoxenes' chromatic genus, here, the tetrachord is dominated by a minor third that takes up more than half the space, and then the rest of it, called the pycnon, is split into two half steps. Pycnon is Greek for condensed because the minor third is actually bigger than the entire rest of the tetrachord put together, so the other two intervals are just sort of squeezed in there. And this gets even worse in Aristoxenes' third group, the enharmonic genus, where the leap has grown into a major third, leaving the pycnon as just a single half step. Now you might think there's no way to split that in half, but fortunately we can bust out a thing called quarter tones, which we've talked about before. These are basically just half a half step, which is unsurprisingly useful for splitting a half step in half. Half. Anyway, we can see the influence of Aristoxenes' tetrachords in the more modern system. The enharmonic genus is largely gone because we don't use quarter tones very often these days, but the diatonic genus became the major, minor, and Phrygian tetrachords, and the chromatic genus became the harmonic one. But his system assumed that every scale should have notes a perfect fourth above and below the root, and while most of the popular ones still do, some are a little less cooperative. For example, Lydian has an augmented fourth, and altered has a diminished one. This means we need to name new tetrachords in order to accommodate these scales, and we might as well name them after the scales they come from, so the Lydian tetrachord is all whole steps, and the altered tetrachord is like the Phrygian one, but smaller. As another brief aside, the Lydian tetrachord is crucial to understanding something I wanted to talk about in the Jacob Collier video, Super Ultra Hyper Mega Meta Lydian. This is a scale he's talked about that's basically just a stack of Lydian tetrachords forever. Now, if we do this the way we've been doing with a fixed octave, we get this, which is called the whole tone scale because it's all whole steps. But Jacob doesn't do that. Instead, he fixes the perfect fifth so that each tetrachord starts a half step above the end of the last one, creating this, where we actually overshoot the octave. Lydian has a famously bright sound, and Jacob argues that by stacking Lydian tetrachords like this, you can keep that brightness going forever, creating, in effect, the ultimate major scale. Kinda. Moving back to normal music, you can find all sorts of new scales just by combining different tetrachords. In this video, we've talked about 6, major, minor, Phrygian, Lydian, harmonic, and altered. With just those, you can make 36 different scales, and that number only goes up if you include things like the chromatic variations or even the enharmonic ones. And other cultures have developed even more tetrachords, like this Arabic one, that employs an interval called a neutral second, but as always, it can be dangerous to just drop non-Western ideas into Western models because you lose a lot of the cultural context. Still though, the real strength of tetrachords is that they give you a simple way to tell what the scale will sound like, as long as you know the sounds of its component parts. Speaking of simple ways to know what things are like, Skillshare is offering 2 free months of premium membership to the first 500 people who click the link in the description. Man, I am really good at transitions. Anyway, one class I've been going through recently is about how to be a music producer made by Focus, an actual Grammy-winning producer. It's been really interesting. As someone who's never really done much professional recording, I always sort of knew that a producer was an important part of the process, but I'd never really understood exactly what their job was beyond just somehow making things sound better. Focus breaks down his process, his goals, and his role in the studio so that even an abstract theorist like myself can follow along. And that's just one of the thousands of classes on Skillshare, all of which you get unlimited access to with a premium membership, which is, again, free for 2 months with a link in the description, and if you want to keep going, it's just 10 bucks a month after that. And it's not just music stuff either. They've got classes on cooking, business, web development, basically anything you might want to learn to do. And again, I cannot stress this enough. Premium membership, free for 2 months, link in the description. Bye! Anyway, thanks for watching, and thanks to our Patreon patrons for supporting us and making these videos possible. If you want to help out and get some sweet perks like sneak peeks of upcoming episodes, there's a link to our Patreon on screen now. You can also join our mailing list to find out about new episodes, like, share, comment, subscribe, and above all, keep on rocking.